This is your favorite international radio network, 94.3 KD11 World Your Station. And today is Father's Day. Big day, isn't it? We've been celebrating Mother's Day for the longest time. And I remember a few years ago, may not be more than 5 to 7 years ago, that we started talking more. Actually, the fathers themselves started talking more about, you know, how is it that we don't get the kind of attention that you mothers are getting? And I'm really, really glad this is happening. And we've been doing it ever since. Well, it's been happening for a long time now. And today is one such Father's Day where we're going to take time out to talk to fathers, to thank our fathers, to, you know, maybe even get some fatherly hacks, or, you know, hacks that fathers usually use that they can even suggest the other fathers to use, the younger ones especially. On the show today in this special is one of the foremost names we have in the world of comedy, and that is Amit Tandon. Amit, it is so nice to have you on the show. Happy Father's Day.
Thank you, Annie. Thank you so much. Finally, somebody recognizes fathers.
You know, I'm sure as a father, when it all began, it must have been so tough because you're not prepared. Nobody's ever prepared, are they?
No, you're never prepared.
And then you do it in partnership. We're going to come to that. But I'd like to ask you, you know, you're a fabulous comedian. And your stand-up acts are such where people of all ages can enjoy. But when you took that call, because you've also been a corporate professional, if it hadn't worked out, what was plan B?
Honestly, I didn't really have a plan B. How I did it was, I was running my own business. So I'm somebody who doesn't easily take risk. You know, I would have taken it if I was alone.
Okay.
I had my family. So okay. I was very clear that I'll get into comedy full time only when I start making as much money from comedy as I'm making from my business. So I was running a business of my own.
Okay.
So for 7 years, I was doing both comedy and business together. Din mein business, raat ko comedy.
Wow.
Okay. Because the whole point was that, you know, this is my choice, not my kids or my wife's choice. So I can't tell my kids ki ab tum saste school mein jaoge kyunki papa ko comedy karna hai. Right. So I did that like for 6-7 years before I, like, when I started making more money from comedy than I was making from my business, then finally I closed.
Wow, that is some planning. And in that, of course, the other comedians who may have thought of it later in life really have something to take from, because it's extremely important, I think, to calculate all these little bit of risks that you can take and you cannot take. So I'm glad you being very honest, you didn't have plan B because you had kind of calculated all the risks and also worked towards it. That's amazing. There are these lovely videos he does with his son, and he plays along very well, huh, Amit?
He's good with camera.
So I'm sure he also gives you ideas. Do you all kind of, you know, brainstorm where since he's a younger generation, he says, you know, this is what is going to work with us younger generation. So do you all have those discussions at the table?
Yeah, we have those discussions because he wants to do stuff. He's not sure. My daughter wants to do stuff. They check with me. I just ensure that they just don't put out anything on social media without showing it to me, because it's an age when, you know, you've got to be a little bit more responsible. So we have those discussions ki kya karna hai, kya nahi karna hai, and then they take a decision. I want to know what the younger generation is doing, but at the same time, I also want to ensure that, you know, since I know the perils of social media,
right,
they don't fall into it.
Right. Now, I want to go back to the beginning. I asked you about plan B. You didn't have one, and that's super because you had calculated everything. But when did this comedy worm set itself in you? And when were you convinced that this is something I have to do? I have to have an outlet, you know, to kind of bring this out to people and see how people react. When did it start?
I was 35 years old and I was running my own business. And this was more like, you know, a hobby that I went to an open mic. You know, I went to an open mic and I saw, you know, people getting on stage and talking. And that's when I realized, you know, you can go on stage, talk about your problems and probably get paid in the process also. So there's nothing better. Ye therapy se ulta hai bilkul. Like, you know, in therapy, you pay somebody so that they listen to your problems. In comedy, you get paid and you still, you know, people listen to your problem. So,
wow, it's a win-win situation. I like the way you put it. I love your approach also. So then you started with the open mics, and then it was a smooth flow, or did you kind of learn along the way?
No, you have to learn a lot along the way, because for me, you know, stage fright was a big challenge in the beginning, you know, so I was always looking at the paper and not the audience.
Right, right. So
then you realize, you know, what people like to, you know, what people laugh at, okay. And then in comedy, there's a stage, you know, which comes, you know, with people. It takes time, you know, sometimes 3 years, sometimes 5 years, 7 years.
Sure, sure.
When you discover your voice, you know, where you have a unique voice. In comedy, you can't be like, if you try to become another Johnny Lever, or you try to become another Raju Srivastava or a Zakir Khan, you know, you will never become anything. You need to have your unique voice. So that, you know, takes some time. So it takes 3 to 4 years, 5 years easily before you identify that this is my voice and this is what people connect to.
That's beautiful. Now, speaking of, you know, starting at an age where you were pretty much otherwise settled, you had a family, you had children, but you wanted to try this out. There was some sort of motivation. So I believe your family kind of supported you in whatever you wanted to do, right? It wasn't all that difficult to tell them that you wanted to also do this.
Yeah, as long as the money was flowing in.
Yeah, true. I know.
No, but for my wife, I think, you know, a lot of credit goes to my wife, because it takes a lot of courage to support, you know, a performing artist, you know, because the way people judge you in performing arts in India, you know, and you are part of the industry. So, you know, it's, you know, it's not all, you know, hunky-dory in the beginning. You know, you've got to struggle. So she saw through that. And then, you know, in last 4 or 5 years, she literally single-handedly managed the kids and the family. Our movement to Bombay and everything, when I was traveling like 300 days every year, you know, for 4 years between 2016 to 19. So a lot of credit goes to her.
That's beautiful. So you had moments in family when everybody would gather and bade bolte honge. Ek joke sunao yaar.
Arre, that's the most painful part of this.
So how did you tackle it? Were you very easy with them and you were very comfortable? And so you were, of course, you were comfortable, but then, you know, you didn't want to let them down. So you would always keep cracking these jokes. And did they tell you you should be doing comedy too?
No. So what I do is, you know, initially it was a bit of a struggle because, you know, you are used to getting on stage and telling a joke where everybody else was listening. Here, nobody's listening in the family. Nobody's listening. They want to contribute to your joke. So now, yeah, see, I come from a Punjabi family. So everybody drinks. So after first peg, everybody wants to laugh. But by third peg, everybody's like, I am also a comedian. Good. So now I tell simply, you know, anybody in a party, if somebody says that, you know, why don't you crack a joke? And I said, mera joke nikalta hi nahi hai jab tak log 500 rupees ki ticket na khareede. So
they have their answer. Very terse. Amit, so tell me some hacks that you can share with fathers, things that you have done when you were growing up, growing up with children, of course, and watch them grow, where, you know, it was initially, you know, you just don't know what to do. You try to follow your father's footsteps, and then you want to try to come into your own and be a father that, you know, will be a different kind of inspiration to your son. Are there some things that you did, worked out, which maybe others also can use?
There are 2-3 things that I do, you know. So one is, you know, I think every father wants to be a better version of his father.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Everybody feels ke kuch to parents ne galat kiya, now, you know, I will not do this. No. And second, you know, my hack as a father is that, you know, listen to them always when they come to talk, okay? And stay out of their way as much as you can, unless they're doing something illegal.
Right.
Okay. Right. As long as I can afford something, I will always say yes to them. You know,
correct.
After that, because till the age of 18, they are my responsibility. After that, they are anyway society's problem. So,
I remember you used this line in one of your acts. I do remember. Well, so I think as fathers, some hacks, in fact, this is a very important point he's raised, is listen to your children. And of course, not come in their way too much, thinking that, you know, you're being this helicopter father and helicopter mom feature, which we tend to do, being very overprotective. So you've not been a very overprotective father, have you?
No, and I'm not somebody who goes after them, padlo, because what I've also seen is that, you know, if you look at all your friends in your school time and map their success against the marks that they got in their exams, there is no correlation.
Sure.
It's not that the toppers of your time are the most successful people today in life, you know. So I just tell them that do what you want to, you know, as long as you pass your classes, I'm fine with it. Any idea, anything that you want to talk about, I'm always happy to listen, because what happens is that fathers don't listen.
Correct.
They always start from that position of that what you are going to bring to me is stupid. And that's where kids stop talking to you.
Sure. Very, very crucial point raised there. Very, very crucial point. Well, being a father, I guess, has not been easy, but he's found his way through. He shared some of the very important points we need to keep in mind as parents, so to speak, not just fathers, but I think even as mothers, we need to listen to our child and not be overprotective and, you know, wonder or feel pained if they get hurt. I think it's very normal and natural for children to get hurt, and you must let them as things go along. Are you ready for the rapid fire round, Amit?
Yeah, very much ready.
Who was your childhood celebrity crush?
Aishwarya Rai.
Ooh. If you were to be a comic hero, superhero, for one day, who would it be?
I would be Superman.
Yeah? And why is that?
At least you save money on travel. Like, you can go anywhere in the world. Is the, you know, I want to go to some of the cities right now, which I can't. So
yeah, you spoke like a true you know, metro inhabitant, because that is the woes that every metro person faces. And even as markets have opened up, it's getting more and more difficult to actually be on the roads. That is so true. Who are some of your favorite musicians, you know, someone you like to listen to?
I keep on changing right now. You know, I listen to Eminem, okay, and I also listen to these days. So I listen to a lot of old Hindi music also. So I listen to Hemant Kumar these days.
Wow,
he's one of those singers who's not been recognized as much as, you know,
correct.
Some of the others like Mohammad Rafi and all, but had amazing voice. I'm a big fan of Sonu Nigam and Alka Yagnik.
Ah. Okay, do you have a favorite video game?
Super Mario used to be my favorite. I didn't play anything.
I've heard this from so many of them, okay? Super Mario was something, must say. Okay, which dessert makes you go weak in your knees?
Halwa made by my wife.
Oh, how romantic. How romantic. You didn't say made by my mom, so that's really nice. what's your favorite time of the day?
It's the time that I get to spend with my kids and wife together in the room. It's normally 11:30 in the night when we sit down and play a game.
Oh, nice. Oh, how cool. What's your favorite beverage?
Beverage is beer.
Okay, as a father, has there been any regret being a father that you've had and that you felt that maybe because I learned from this mistake, I'm going to keep telling others about it so others don't do this mistake? Is there anything like this that has happened in your life?
I think I could have been more patient when my kids were younger. So maybe I should have, like, because I was not good at teaching them, although I was good in studies myself. So maybe should have been more patient, you know, as a father in the beginning and, you know, while teaching them especially.
And what have been some of the best moments? Give me two best moments being a father.
Best moments? I think one was because my daughter is not very expressive, but then we were in Singapore and we were taking these rides and, you know, nobody would go for those crazy rides with her.
Correct.
You know, those really scary ones. And I sat with her in all the rides. And then when she came down and she gave me a big hug and kissed me. So, that's, you know, one of my sweetest moments. And with my son, I think the first time I saw him get on stage and do stand up, and I had like worked with him, so I was very proud when he did that.
Oh damn cool Thank you so much. With that, we have come to the end of the rapid fire round also. Thank you for letting, you know, your personal side also be shared here on Afternoons with Annie on this special day called Father's Day. You have been a great father and I don't see any regret you should have whatsoever, because I guess as people, we do make mistakes and mistakes are also part of our learning. And we, you know, of course, after that, today you are very, very patient. Today you listen to your children a lot more than you may have in the beginning, and it's just great, and they're so happy with you and so proud of you themselves. I can see that in the videos you put up too.
Thank you so much. Yeah, it's somehow, you know, it's good that even as teenagers they talk to you. I think that's
that's a blessing. That is definitely.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for your time, and happy Father's Day again. Keep up the good work.
Thank you. Thank you.
94.3 One World, your station. 94.3